Hello everyone, and welcome to the wireless router and components configuration session. This is the third module of mobility series. My name is Shubhrendu Guhaniyogi. I am working as a CCNA instructor trainer and also Cisco certified instructor and assistant professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at Sir Padmapat Singhani University, Udaipur, Rajasthan, located in India. It is my immense pleasure to welcome you all today on the journey of configuration of wireless networks and different components and different devices, connecting devices like wireless router, access points. So coming to agenda, so if you look at the agenda, there are three things which we need to cover. First, we need to cover components like wireless access point, wireless router. Then I will take you through different configuration of different wireless clients like PCs, smartphone, laptops. I will be showing you through simulator, that is Cisco Packet Tracer. But there is a little difference between Packet Tracer configuration and the real life configuration, which I will discuss also. And finally, a small demo in Cisco Packet Tracer by setting up a home network to demonstrate how to access internet. So if we start, the first thing we need to discuss that how to configure wireless access point and wireless router. So we'll be showing you separately how to configure wireless access point and wireless router. So before configuring any wireless access point or wireless router, let me just explain a few things about how to configure wireless LAN. So basically there are two modes by which we can set up any wireless devices. So wireless setup modes are divided into two parts. One is ad hoc mode and next one is infrastructure mode. Now, whenever we are configuring any wireless LAN, there are five ways we can configure. One is peer-to-peer network, client and access point, multiple access point and roaming, using an extension point, and using directional antenna. So in this slide, I'm going to show you that what are the basic hardware requirements of wireless LAN. So these are the different devices required. So basically when we are creating some topologies in real life network, in Wi-Fi network, we need to have basically access point or wireless connecting devices. And in end user devices, we need to have wireless adapter cards. And if we would like to configure in between different building, we need to have directional antennas, and also for extension purpose, for like a wireless hub or wireless when we configure any wireless network, when we are extending a network, we always or we rather take help of wireless access points. And finally, this entire wireless network need to be connected to a wired network. So this is also a required. So we need to have the connectivity to wired network also. So every wireless device have connectivity to connect to the wireless wired network by LAN cable. That's RJ45 connector is available. So when we are talking about wireless LAN models, we are having two types of connectivity. One is called ad hoc networking, known as peer-to-peer networking. So basically this is used within a small range of devices, where different devices are connected with each other in an ad hoc mode. So in such ad hoc network, devices does not require any wired network, so they are purely connecting. So Bluetooth is one of the technology which is widely used in today's world by creating such ad hoc network, and we have also wireless sensor networks and other devices which can be a type of such ad hoc network. So also hotspot, Wi-Fi hotspot is also one kind of configuration where we can have such ad hoc network. But whenever we are configuring any wireless infrastructure network, we need to have devices like connecting devices like access point or wireless router. So the key difference between a structured wireless network and ad hoc network is that we need to introduce such a connecting device which is called access point or wireless connected, which we are going to configure. So before that, let's quickly go through different types of connections. So the first thing is basic wireless peer-to-peer network, which does not require any administration and configuration. This is two different devices can be connected with each other if they have wireless adapter card, and we can have such connectivity also. So normally we can create such ad hoc network in between two or three PCs or laptops if we have. But when we go for infrastructure mode, we need to go for this kind of environment where we have a client and we have access point, where you can see access point basically connected to wired device, wired network, and this is the wireless part. So basically, if we talk about access point has two parts. One, it is connected to wired network, and another part it is connected to different devices. So it is providing access to wireless devices. So each clients like PC, smartphone, laptop or wireless printer can have connectivity through this access point. So this is basically a wireless switch. So in this topology we are showing single access point, but we can have also multiple access point, and in such cases we should have a access point controller. So the next topic is, or the next type of configuration is multiple access point and roaming. So at large, when we design any Wi-Fi campus in network, then for example in our SPSU college campus, or there are several industries where different access points are required for configuration or for connectivity to cover more range of network. So we can have multiple access point. So basically, when we have multiple access point, we need to have access point controller. We call it as AP controller, and we will be discussing in details how we can have such devices, such configurations. So basically the goal is while roaming, the end user devices should have a connectivity. So such access point has different limitations in indoor and outdoor. So normally the basic challenges in such cases is basically how many access point you need to have, or how many access point required for the configuration, and what is the positioning of access point, then we can achieve the better connectivity for end user devices. Now we are going to discuss about what is extension point. So extension point can be used when we need to extend our topology, physical topology. Then this extension points are used, and these are actually used to relay the signal from one device to another device, one access point to another access point by this extension point. So this actually give a more area, more physical area coverage in any Wi-Fi campus. So next is using directional antenna. So in this case we can have wireless LAN in one building, and which is a source. For example, if this is source and this is destination, the data will be relayed through this device. So directional antennas need to be situated on the top of the building, and if we are using two directional antenna, then each should face each other, and then they can be connected. So for example, in a location, if you have two offices which need to be connected in wireless fashion, so basically we need to install two directional antenna on top of on rooftop, and they can be faced each other, so that the connection can be done. So when we are discussing about configuring wireless access point, there are two types of devices. One is wireless access point, which is nothing but a switch, and the second one is wireless router. So wireless access point is basically a switch where you need to have the connectivity. So it's nothing but, we can call it is nothing but a wireless switch. So whenever we configure any wireless access point, first we need to connect this particular access point to a PC by a wired network, and then configure that wireless port later on. So while configuring wireless port, first the best practices is we need to not to use the default SSID which is coming with the factory or from the manufacturer. We need to configure SSID, a proper SSID, because SSID is a service set identifier. So this identifies the device, the access point in the network. So if we have multiple wireless access point and a single access point controller, for a better connectivity we should have all the access points should have same kind of configuration. So same kind of configuration means same kind of, or same SSID, or same types of authentication or password. So first and foremost thing, the best practices, if we talk about best practices, we need to create a meaningful SSID or a proper SSID for the home network. Then configuring the authentication, that we need to select the configuration. So basically if we check different authentication mode, the first one is called wired equivalent privacy, that is called WEP, and second one is called WPA, Wi-Fi protected access. So we have WPA1 and WPA2, WPA and WPA2. So these are the three different types of security modes available when we configure authentication. That's WEP, WPA and WPA2. So first we need to check that what is available with that client and with the device. So this is very much required when we configure. So when we are configuring authentication, so first we need to choose the authentication and then the encryption type. So basically when we are talking about WEP, this also have a security algorithm and which is a traditional standard which came with IEEE 802.11, which was ratified in the year 1997. So this is the first wireless authentication mechanism, that's WEP, which we still do not use. But second one which we use is basically WPA and WPA2. But the difference between WPA and WPA2 is WPA uses TKIP and WPA2 is using AES. Okay. TKIP is a temporal key integrity protocol. So if we are choosing encryption type temporal key integrity protocol, this is no longer secure. So we always need to go for the best practices. Always we need to go for WPA2, which is the best one, which is advanced encryption standard, which is AES algorithm, which is used. So in WPA2 also we have two types of methods. One is WPA standard and one is advanced. And in advanced there is something called PSK, which is called pre-shared key, so which is distinguished, which is required to take help of a RDS server. So if we have large enterprise or a bigger Wi-Fi network, there we need to provide username and password for each and every user where we need to take help of RDS server. In that case also we use AES algorithm, but there is some other advanced level of authentication which is provided. So by using by giving each and every user a particular username and password, that is possible when we actually have a RDS server. So both in WPA2 and WPA we have, but we always should go for WPA2 enterprise connectivity. The next one is called MAC authentication, which is a best practice. We should also disable SSID broadcast and also go for MAC authentication. So MAC authentication can restrict end devices, like if we want to block any particular PC or laptop we can block, or the best practice if we can have that each and every device MAC address is stored in the access point, it is better than we, or access point controller, it is better. So we also have some advanced wireless settings, so that I'm coming to when we are having access point controller we have such kind of setting. So this is a small topology where you can see that we have a wireless WLAN controller. So this is called WLC. When we have a bigger network and we have wireless LAN and more number of access points, we need to have AP controller and AP manager. So this is a small topology where we can see that we have different VLAN available and we have different access point available. So we need to configure wireless LAN controller separately. So what is Cisco wireless controller is, Cisco wireless controller have these different functions which is required and which helps my network to configure in a better way. So this is having flexibility to configure wireless policies, management and security settings. So next few slides I'm going to show you that what are the things you can configure. So when we are looking at commercial aspect, we need to have a access point controller so that we can have same SSID and same authentication and a control in the entire campus or entire Wi-Fi network. So different software versioning is available, but one of the good feature is WIPS, which is called Wireless Intrusion Prevention System, which is there in wireless controller to manage different users. and there is a separate feature for QoS that is called quality of service for voice and video access wired and wireless networks, centralized security, and also support of IPv6. So how you can install a AP manager? When you connect a AP manager, you first connect that AP manager with a wired device, and then insert that wireless LAN hardware access point installation drive. For example, here is D. So go to D colon insert start that setup.exe file, and then you can start the installation. And then first in AP manager you can have option to give the name of SSID and other things. So whenever this is a Cisco Aeronet 1200 series access point, there are different devices available. So whenever you go and configure, there is a express setup. So this is a web browser, so preferably we should go for a web browser configuration by typing the IP address. So either it will be having 10.1.1.1 or 10.1.1.2, something like that, or 192.168.1.1 or 0.1, such kind of wireless IP addresses available. Or basically first when you install, you can also give the IP address to this access point controller. So then you need to find out that who is DHCP server and other things in the network. So once you configure this, the next thing is you need to configure few things like host name, IP address, SNMP, and all those things when you configure the express setup. So first express setup, the basic configuration you need to do. After that you need to go for express security by providing the security and other things. So these are the things when you are configuring wireless access point with AP and AP controller. So in AP configuration, first you need to search who is your DHCP server. Then on the basis of that you can configure your WLC, wireless LAN controller, and finally the configuring different switches and APs for this. Then the next stage is AP registration to WLC. Whenever you have several access points, so we need to register all access points to wireless LAN controllers. So after that, when you have the entire configuration done, you have, this is a summary. You can monitor that what are the different devices, what are the access point, different access points, and their radios and all. So you need to basically register them. If, for example, if you have 3 or 4 access point connected to this network, so they need to be registered with that WLC controller. Now this is the statistics which give you the port details and whether the link is up or down. So once you configure, you can have the statistics of the entire networks, like how many packets are going and what are the different devices and how these ports are connected, and what are the different wireless LANs, what are their SSIDs and all. So anytime you can go and change the SSID. The best practice is that all devices, all access points should have same SSID, then the mobility will be better and the handoff will be better in between the devices. So you can create a VLAN and multiple VLAN, but it is the better that everything should be monitored and controlled from that access point controller. So these are the controller options where you can enable and disable few features. And always we need to note down the IP addresses, and then finally we can go to that IP address and configure each and every device. So basically we have different devices which in the controller interfaces you can see that. And if you want to add few devices, click on new and add devices here, and you can configure different VLAN which is available. And once you register access point, that AP's hardware details are available with that access point controller. So all those AP details need to be registered. So this you can also provide a static IP so that you can connect to that particular access point and configure them. Then the most important part is in wireless selecting the channel, that is selecting the radio RF. So once you select the radios and types of the depending on type of radios, your access point will be functional. So it is always desirable to configure that radios, and accordingly it should match your network. So then only you will be able to connect these devices into your network. So this is after configuring, this is a summary. So after setting, you need to save and reboot the entire system, then it will be functional. So before configuring wireless router, let me show you that we have wireless devices available. So if you go to wireless devices, you can see there is a wireless access point. So let me show you quickly. In real life the access point configuration is different, but let me give you a quickly connectivity. So let me take a PC and laptop, server, printer, wireless tablet, smartphone, and these devices. Let's connect them to wireless access point. So you can see that whenever you take these devices in Cisco Packet Tracer, they are automatically connected. So why it is automatically connected? Because we are not using the best practice here. So in such cases the devices are connected automatically because this is having default configuration. These devices does not have wireless adapter card. So basically what we need to do, we need to check wireless adapter card. So I am changing the wireless adapter card. Once we change the wireless adapter card, these devices will be automatically connected. So you can see the devices are automatically getting connected. In laptop also we need to do the same thing, remove that wired one and take the wireless card. You have an option to add one more wireless card here, so I'm not removing this. So in printer also you need to take out this device, and now you can see all devices are connected to access point. So now what I'm doing, I'm making this server as a DHCP server, for example DHCP server. So I'm giving IP address to this particular device. So going to wireless, I'm providing a static IP address, for example 192.168.0.1. this is the IP address. Now if you go and check the services in DHCP, you need to put the wireless on, change the default gateway, give the starting address as 10 and save it and make the service on. Now if you go back and check PCs started getting IP addresses, which was not possible before, but now you can see that every devices are getting IP addresses. Okay, now change it, started getting IP addresses. Now Now these devices can communicate with each other, but you can see that configuration, the SSID is default. So basically when we are configuring, we need to configure. So for example, here I am going to show you, I am giving a SSID as Cisco and choosing, first let's choose WEP, and then you can give that password. Here you can also give WPA and WPA2. So the best is when we go for WPA2, the encryption type is AES. So here in this case, for example, I'm giving Cisco 123. You can choose AES or TKIP, but AES is for WPA2 and TKIP is for WPA. So this is I am providing in each and every devices. Now you can see whenever we are configuring, okay, this information need to be provided. So once you provide such information, then the connectivity will happen. First you need to provide it in wireless, in server, sorry. Now different devices will be getting connected. So almost created a small topology using access point. Now let's come to this device, Cisco, and WPA2, Cisco 123. This is connected. Again, printer will get connected. Then coming to smartphone, again in end user devices, you need to keep one thing in your mind, that whenever we are connecting, we need to provide two things. First SSID, and then the corresponding authentication mode. So whenever we are configuring, this need to be there. Now this is all about configuring wireless access point. Next is configuring wireless router. So I am already connected to a Linksys router, so let me go and let me go to Mozilla Firefox and configure wireless router. So again, whenever we are configuring wireless router, the best practice is same, that we need to connect my PC for configuration. Then once we connect, we need to provide the IP address 192.168.0.1 here, which is the Linksys E2000 router's username and password. By default it is admin. So whenever we are connecting first time, it is admin. Then a screen will open like that, the basic setup screen. So first is connecting the PC for configuration. You can also connect in any LAN cable, and then using LAN cable you can connect this PC. There are two parts in any wireless router. One is called internet part and one is called LAN part. You need to connect this PC in LAN part, because internet part, where you need to configure internet port when you are configuring internet. So here in this case, whenever we are configuring, we need to first connect the PC to that wireless router and start configuring. So again, best practices is configuring these things, like configuring internet port, configuring SSID, configuring DHCP, configuring authentication, selecting encryption type, MAC authentication and advanced wireless settings. So basically, whenever we connect to any Linksys router or Cisco wireless router, the first screen will appear like this. The first screen will appear like this, where we have the basic configuration the first thing is to set up the basic setup, where you can change the language, you can change the internet setup, you can change host name, change the domain name, change the IP address of the home network, that is the IP address which is need to be provided in this particular device. So basically the difference between wireless access point and wireless router is, wireless access point is basically a layer 2 device, and this is a layer 3 device where we can configure IP addresses, and this also can act as a DHCP server. So you can enable and disable DHCP server, but you need to create the DHCP pool and you need to provide all those informations for your network. So here in this case you can see that I have configured my wireless router as a DHCP server. So device name, IP address and all those things I have provided. So whenever you change any configuration, you need to go and save this. So finally, once you complete, so I am basically in India, so you can also change the time zone. So after changing everything, you need to reboot so that it can work properly. So this is a basic setup. So in internet setup there are basic 3 types of configuration. One is called automatic configuration through DHCP. Then second is static IP, which you can see that we are using here. And third is PPUI. Once we select PPUI, this particular router will act as a DSL modem. So PPUI, if we are configuring this router as a PPUI, we need to provide username and password. So whenever we connect to any wireless device, we need to first check few things. First, which firmware version I am using. So there is a little change when we are configuring different wireless router model. There is a slight change. The basic configuration is same, because there are basically major menus like setup menu, wireless security, application gaming, administration, and finally you can check the status. So I'm going to take you through all those basic configuration. So we are now in a basic setup mode. In basic setup mode, you can have basic setup, DDNS, MAC address cloning and advanced routing. If you click on advanced routing, you can see that there is a NAT, dynamic routing and all those things available. Now if you want to connect your device to internet, you need to have NAT enabled, or else you can disable it. But basically it is the best practices that you need to go for such kind of option, that NAT should be enabled, or if you have any dynamic routing protocol like RIP available, then you need to disable NAT and enable this dynamic routing protocol. So for example, here in this case you can enable dynamic routing protocol, or if you want to disable dynamic routing protocol, since this is having connected to two broadcast domain, one is internet domain or the outer world domain and your home network, you need to configure routing. So in routing also you can take a third party help of third party router. So coming back to basic setup, whenever we are setting up internet, we can always go for PPUI. In PPUI we can configure ISP's details, where we will be given or provided with a username and password. Now once you configure the internet, so the next part is configure the network of the home network of the router. So here in this case I am also connected to internet and I have configured a static IP. So whenever you are configuring, or we are configuring the network setup, we need to give router IP address. You can change the router IP address. So by default it comes with 192.168.0.1. So you can create your own IP address and subnet mask. And after that you need to configure accordingly your home network's DHCP. So Once you configure this, you need to save the settings. So this is the basic setup where you can have internet connection type, your own router's IP address, and if you your choice whether you want to disable or enable DHCP server or not. We preferably enable DHCP server if we do not have any DHCP server available in my home network. The next part is administration. So let's go back and check. In administration, by default your username is admin, so it is better that we need to change the password, router password, and also that other things like web access configuration, whether you want to provide web access to this particular device or not. So you can choose both HTTP or HTTPS, or you can choose either. So it is better that we should go for HTTPS. Then remote access management, you can also choose whether you want to enable and disable remote access management. You need to disable it because this is a little vulnerable, but if you want to enable it, you need to provide a particular IP address and remote management port. Change the remote management port so that anyone cannot actually, any intruder cannot use it. So next part is UPnP. Now it is better that the best practice is we need to enable UPnP. So this UPnP is something like universal plug and play. So this is a set of networking protocol that permits this network devices such as personal computer, printer and access points and mobile devices or wireless devices to seamlessly discover this particular router. So this is normally required for residential network. So UPnP technology is a industry standard that enable simple and robust connectivity to standalone devices and end user devices of different vendor. The concept of UPnP is an extension of plug and play. This is a technology for dynamically attaching different devices directly to a computer. Although in such cases the plug and play is not a normal concept, this is not like earlier plug and play concept, but in such cases the device discovery is little easier. So in home network it is better that you have this UPnP feature enabled. After that, next is backup and storage configuration. So this is the basic configuration of wireless router. Then we are coming to the most important part, that is the best practice part, where we need to configure our wireless device. So in coming to the wireless tab, we have the basic configuration. Like if we have Wi-Fi protected setup, we can always go for a wizard mode, but we can always go for a manual configuration. So first, in manual configuration, we need to set the wireless band. So in my cases, I am using 2.4 gigahertz. Now next is you can choose that radio mode. So whether BG mixed, wireless G, B, N, or you if you want to go for a mixed mode, you can do it. I am choosing mixed mode. So you can choose any mode. The next one is choosing SSID. You need to choose your SSID. So this is required, this is very much required so that your wireless device can be identified in the network. So when once you have or once you choose your SSID, so this need to be common in your home network. So once you choose your wireless SSID, then this SSID need to be provided to wireless clients, those who want to be connected with you. Next is channel width and the channel number of channels and types of channel. We are choosing, you can choose auto in both the cases. Then the best practice is SSID broadcast need to be disabled. So if you enable it, any client can see your SSID. So it is better that you can actually manually go and select your SSID to your end user device and client and provide this information to client. So SSID broadcast, it is better that we need to disable SSID broadcast. So in basic wireless security, two best practice we have. One is selecting or choosing SSID, giving a name of SSID, and next is disabling SSID broadcast. So this is the basic configuration. In basic configuration, we have wireless network name, channel, and types of channel, and finally the SSID broadcast, enable or disable. So we need to disable it. Next is wireless security mode. So in wireless security mode, we have already discussed wireless security mode earlier. So these are the different security mode available. So the old one is WEP, which is already we have discussed that WAD equivalent privacy, which came with IEEE 802.11 standard. So this was revised and it is sometime called IEEE 802.11i standard, which was available in the year 2003. So this Wi-Fi Alliance intended to use the old security measure. So once you select WEP, so it will give you a warning, and after that you can choose your encryption standard. So let's choose a higher bit encryption standard and giving a password Cisco, and then you need to generate the key. So you can see the key is generated. So this is not a very secured one, so we need to avoid such security measure in which is called WEP. The next one which came is called WPA, and there are two things. One is called WPA personal and WPA enterprise. What happens in WPA personal? Once you choose WPA personal, this is called Wi-Fi protected area, WPA 1 is. And once you choose WPA personal, that encryption standard, then you have to provide the password, which is called passphrase. This will use the encryption standard, which is called TKIP, which is called Temporal Key Integrity Protocol. This is a stopgap encryption protocol which was introduced after replacing the WEP encryption which we have seen earlier. So both methods are little similar. If you see the functionality of TKIP and WEP, it is secure. The security feature is not so good, but the security functionality is same. And that is the reason we are no more using TKIP. So it may happen that your client doesn't support WPA 2. That time you can go for such configuration. The best one is you need to go for WPA 2. So WPA 2 personal is when you go for WPA 2 personal, you can always go for a mixed mode also. Okay, so that it is better that both the clients can be connected. So your device is secured, but the configuration is little better in this case. So once you select WPA 2, it is using advanced encryption standard, which is called AES. So this is more secured and came late after 2005, so in later stage where it is found that AES encryption is better, so we call it as more secure standard. And this can use we can use a strong passphrase which can prevent the brute force attack. And security weakness in compared to others, we can say that WPA2 is better. But the best thing is that we should go for a WPA2 enterprise. Whenever we go for a WPA2 enterprise, we need to give a Redis server. So whenever we are providing a Redis server, so this Redis server will provide a authentication, and there is a pre-shared key which is called PSK. This PSK is generally the encryption passphrase which is required to shared among this Redis server. So you can change the port also, so the attacker cannot understand. This is better wireless security, because the attacker cannot understand that in which port they are exchanging the password, so it is not easy. So this Redis server, we will be using a unique key. This unique key is shared among Redis server and your wireless device. This WPA2 uses AES, and after that also this there will be a mixed mode approach, because this PSK2 mixed mode approach provide AES for basic authentication, and after that the Redis server will provide a username and password. So this is we consider it as better, or this as far as security is concerned, this is little better. So the next part is wireless MAC address configuration. So let's go to LS MAC filter. So we need to enable, the best practice is we need to enable it, but there are two things. One is, first, for example, all the devices in this topology are connected to this wireless access point. Now if I want to block some, so I can still do it. So I can go to go and change that we can actually provide that MAC address. So if I want to block a particular device, we can do the same. Now this is the best secure mechanism, where we can have only the devices which is registered or which are registered with this particular wireless router can get access. So this is the best feature which we can incorporate by enabling wireless MAC filter and permit all those PCs which are having connectivity. Now once you provide the proper MAC address, then only you are allowed to get connected to the network. So in such cases, my network will be, I can say that it's best secured. So the next part is advanced wireless setting, where we can check the basic rate, control TX rate, and antenna selections, and all those advanced features which is pertaining to the connectivity. So this is coming in advanced wireless setting. So once we configure wireless advanced setting, we can come down to other features. Now next is security. So in security, it is always better that we need to enable that firewall protection. We can also have we can also use a third party firewall or the internet filter in that device, like multicasting, NAT redirection, some proxy server setting and all. So this feature is also there. Now next, one of the important aspect is application and gaming. So in application and gaming, let's go and see what is there. So in between there is something more in my router that is called access restriction. Like those who know that what is access policy, you can create a access policy also. So some features are available here. Now the final one is called application and gaming. So application and gaming, it is not exactly some kind of gaming and all. So this is some additional functionality in the device, where we can provide some additional feature in the devices like VPN connectivity, IPsec, and some special attention to some devices which is running with some better or more bandwidth when it require more bandwidth. If we can actually allow these ports, it will be better. So there are five things. One is called single port forwarding or port range forwarding. Next is port range triggering, DMZ and QS. So you can actually choose any of the application here. So for example, I want to give some facility for download to a particular server. If I am enabling it, then this particular device will be getting preference in my router. So this FTP services will be having a priority for this 192.168.0.10. And we can also have you know, different like TFTP. So this port, internal and external port, will be open for this particular devices. Or we can customize, like providing for example VPN. So VPN is also, for example, there. So I do not know the port, and I am using port number 1000 to port number 1005. So, and I can select TCP, either TCP or UDP, and I can select both. So in such cases, this particular application will in this particular port range in TCP and UDP, both will be getting a preference. Now next is port range forwarding. In port range forwarding, we can also give application name and start to end IP address. So similar kind of functionality where we have here in this case, we have single port here. There are also multiple port support is there, but here it is better that you know, if we have a port range forwarding, port range, we should go for this kind of feature is called port range forwarding. So port range forwarding is the feature where we can have VPN, IPsec, HTTP. For example, HTTP is using port number 8080. We can still do it. Okay, so this is one of the feature available. And we can also trigger some port ranges from which port, what is my triggered port and what is my forwarded port. We can do it. We can also have DMZ, demilitary zone, where we can have a specific user and specific MAC address. We can create a source to destination where we can give you some additional privilege. The next one is QoS, quality of service. In quality of service, for example, if we enable, we have something like voice device, so we can give the provide the details of this particular voice device by name and MAC address. And if we add that, for example, this is a VoIP phone, and this, if we provide the MAC address and give the priority, then this device or this particular phone, if we have a IP phone in my network which is voice enabled, and we can also, you know, allocate some bandwidth for this device, it will be better. So this is these are the different features. And finally, the status, once we configure and save the settings, we can come down to my router configuration and check that what are the different configuration being made in my device. So these are the status of the wireless settings. And after status, let me just go and give you a quick demo of how to configure a wireless router. So here in this case, my wireless router is there. Now in wireless router, go to GUI, and now let's say I'm giving a static IP address where 1.1.1.2 is there. Subnet mask is 255.255.255.252 is there. So after that, you can save the settings. Sorry, I forgot to give the gateway. So I'm giving the gateway. DNS, for example, is same. So let's configure my device in this particular fashion. Now once I save the settings, this configuration will be saved. Now the best practice is how we need to configure my device. Let's take a PC and configure in a proper form, proper way. So let's connect this particular PC to wireless Ethernet. I'm putting a wrong cable here. So first Ethernet to, for example, LAN 1. Now once, let's fast forward it, and once we are connected, so we need to check the IP address first. So this is 192.168.0.1. So let's go and type 192.168.0.1. So it will ask for a username and password. By default it is admin. So once we provide admin and admin, so this will give me a initial screen of configuration. So you can see these are the configuration. So here in this case, for example, I am using static IP. So this I have configured. So next is you can go and change the password, and after that next we need to go and set up my, already this is there, so we are not changing, but just to change the starting IP address to 10 and giving maximum IP address to 150 and save it. You can change. So it's being changed, and again starting IP address and DNS I am changing to 1.1.1.1 and saving it. So once the configuration is done, now you can see that the range is changed. Now let's do one thing, let's do not take the PC. Instead of PC, let's take a server which will act as a Redis server. So we have already configured, we have already configured this access point with WPA2, and we are using a better configuration here in this case by providing WPA2 enterprise. So let's connect this to Ethernet 1, fast forward, and it can get a IP address automatically, but provide a static IP address, for example 192.168.let's see what DHCP IP is it is getting. So 0.254, let's take 192.168.0.254, and gateway will be 192.168.0.1, and DNS is 1.1.1.1, for example. So let me take one more router as a DNS router. So I'm creating the configuration, one more router as a DNS router. Here in this case, this is, for example, DNS. So you can see I've already connected. So 1.1.1.1, let's give the IP address here is 1.1.1.255.255.255.252. And let's configure this particular device in internet. So this is connected. Now we can check whether this device can ping each other or not. You can see that this is successful. We can also set this as my DNS Cisco, for example, services. Let's go to DNS and make this as www.cisco.com and give IP address as 1.1.1.1. Let's add it on it. Go to HTTP, edit this one, and let's change the color again. Welcome to mobility series. Change it to mobility series so that we can understand. Let's make it red and color is 3. Little changes being made here for So for configuration, I have already made HTTP server services on and DNS on. So let's test www.1.1.1 which need to be there. So let's check whether it is pinging or not. 1.1.1.1. You can see this is working. www.cisco.com is working. So I have already configured. Now this is a small topology what we have configured. So let's go to LS router. So now I am configuring 192.168.0.1. I think it is asking for username and password again, admin. Now once we start the configuration, the next part is wireless security. Now let's go to wireless and give the name as SPSU, which is SSID, and save it. Again, coming to wireless security, let's go for WPA2 enterprise and giving IP address as 192.168.0.254 and secret key as Cisco 123. Let's save it. Now if you come back and check, now I'm using this as a Redis server. So once we come to the services as in the AAA server, you can see 1645 is the port. So let's go and check whether the port number is 16451 or 1645, and Redis server is 192.168.0.254. And here in this case it is 0.1. So client name is 192.168.0.1. So what is 0.1 and 0.254 is? Now here we need to provide the client detail, the like SSID. SSID is SPSU. So going to the server, the client name will be SPSU, client IP will be 1.2.0.1, and secret key need to be match 123. And let's create a username SPSU123 and Cisco 321, changing the IP, changing the password. So then service need to be on. Now you can see that this is my 192.168.0.1. This is my wireless router IP address. 192.168.0.1 is my router IP address. And then the password is 123. Now if you go and check wireless security, it is Cisco 123. This is shared, Cisco 123, this is shared. Now if we cannot configure this properly, then the client cannot be connected. Now let's take a laptop and let's take this laptop here and connect. So I think my wireless configuration is complete. SSID is there now. Wireless security is 192.168.0.254. Now let's come to laptop and coming to PC wireless. You have to go and edit the profile. First, whenever you are editing, go for advanced setup. Now here you have to provide SPSU infrastructure mode. First, you need to provide infrastructure mode, and then you have to select whether you want to go for DHCP or not. Next, the most important thing is changing the security. Now this is WPA2 personal. Now after that you need to provide the login name which you have already created. So this is Cisco 321. So Cisco and password is Cisco 321. Once you save it, You can see you can be connected to the network. Now, once you come and check, this is the user and ID and password which is created in Redis server. So you are actually connecting using the authentication of Redis server and connecting to the wireless router. So this is WPA2 where the username and password is provided from the Redis server itself. Now next, let's do one thing. We forgot to change it. The best practice is we need to disable it. Now what I'm trying to do is here, I need to connect this particular laptop in a secure way. Now let's go to the desktop, or let's copy that MAC address. Now let's go to the wireless router and go to the wireless MAC filter. Let's do one thing. First enable and prevent. First prevent this. So once we prevent this hardware, then you can see that this particular hardware will be no longer available. So once we save it, you can see this hardware is no longer available. You cannot connect. Now let's do the reverse thing. The one which is better, that instead of preventing, let's permit and save it. So once we permit and save it, we can see the laptop can be connected to the wireless router. So this is where my configuration is. Now if you take any other PC, so let's take a PC. So for example, this is a PC2. So this particular PC, let's let me change the LAN card so this becomes wireless. Now this wireless PC, if we configure, so what information you have to do, what configuration you have to do is, first you have to create a SSID. Now SSID you have changed. Now WPA2 you need to provide. You need to provide user name and password where SPSU123. So SPSU123. Even though you can see that this connection is failed. So once you need to connect, you need to connect using the MAC address. So the MAC address, you need to go and provide here. Then only this particular PC can be connected to the network. So this is one of the types of one of the configuration where you can see that one of the configuration where you can see that PC, laptop and smart devices are getting connected to different so now PC with WRS I'm writing. So this PC is connected to WRS and laptop is also connected to WRS. Now we have seen that two types of authentication available here in wireless access point. We are using WPA2 and here we are using WPA2, but we are also taking help of Redis server. So this create a difference. So next, coming to configuring wireless client, PC, smartphone and tablet. Whenever we are configuring wireless client, we need to check few things. First, whenever we are configuring the client, we have shown you the configuration client in Cisco Packet Tracer, but in real life it is not exactly same. The interfaces will be different, like if you see that interface of smartphone, wireless device, the basic principle for configuration is same. Once you go to that wireless configuration, first you have to provide SSID there, manually type or select SSID. Then you have to select, so you have to ask your system administrator what kind of security measure they are taking. So after selecting SSID or configuring SSID, you need to check how that wireless device can be connected to your wireless access point or router. So after configuring, if it is secured, then you need to provide your MAC address to your system administrator so that they can provide your, or they can authenticate your device in their server or in their access point controller or in their router. And finally, configure the IP address. Once you configure the IP address, you have two mode. One is static or dynamic. So you can see that here all the devices has a IP address which is dynamically assigned, or you can also assign static IP address. And finally, how you can check, you can always ping. For example, ping 1.1.1.1, you can see that you can connect to the network. You can also trace route 1.1.1.1. You can see that this is connected to 192.168.0.1 router. So here in this case, you can see my both wireless router and access point is configured. Now in real life, whenever we are configuring PC, smartphone or tablet or laptop, first you need to make your Wi-Fi on. Means if we are having wireless network, Wi-Fi need to be on. So first, if Wi-Fi is on, then there will be option of network SSID. So once we configure Wi-Fi device in real life, so you can select SSID, or you right click on your wireless adapter and provide that SSID, which we are not showing here, but if you are going for any wireless network, so you know, you can manually provide the SSID, then choose the security and choose the password. So this is what I need to do, because in real life and in Cisco Packet Tracer, this is different. So now what we have done, we have understood that how to configure my wireless devices. The next part is setting up a home network to access internet. So basically, we have almost done with setting up a network. Now I'm going to show you that how you can set up your home network. So now let's understand few basic things. Whenever you are building that wireless workspace, you need to find out that what are the devices you have. Now if we have wireless access point, you can have a wireless LAN controller. So a wireless LAN controller is basically configured in the combination of lightweight access point protocol. LW access point protocol is LWAPP to manage lightweight access points in large quantities, and we can, a network administrator or network operation center, you can manage centrally. That wireless LAN controller is a part of any model, any wireless model. So in Cisco wireless model, we have already seen that we have such kind of thing. And then finally, whenever you are choosing your devices, you can also choose an antenna which will give you the wireless system with three fundamental property. First, you need to check the gain, you need to check the direction, you need to check the polarization. So in best practices, we need to check all those basic things. In earlier mobility series, you have already learnt what are the things there with you know, gain, direction and polarization. So basically, to brief you about all those things, is gain is a measure of you know, increase of the power, so that you can get a if you have you can get a better signal inclined. So gain is almost increase of energy that an antenna can add to a radio frequency signal. If it does not have power backup and all, you can see that a particular radio frequency signal is weaker. And when we talk about direction, is the shape of a transmission pattern. So when we increase the gain and we check the angle of radiation properly, and then only there will be a greater advantage and proper coverage as per the distance and angle is concerned. Now the coverage that should be proper, you know, the angle is measured in degree, so there should be proper angle, and these angles are called beam width. Now an antenna, which is actually is a passive device which is used. Now antenna need to be there in all wireless access points to have that increase of the signal. So this antenna is there with external devices, which is used to enhance, or you know, which helps to increase the energy, which is used for in clients which can regain the transmission. So this all depends on your network devices. So beam widths are defined normally in horizontal and vertical planes. Beam widths is a angular radiation pattern of the antenna of any plane. So for an antenna, we need to calculate horizontal beam width and vertical beam width. Now once you plan all those you know, cost, once you plan all those workspace, then only we can proceed forward for my wireless topology. So when we are building workspace, we need to check what specification we require. So depending on cost, we can check we can also select our speed of the devices. This all depends. So on our investment, we can create our topology, wireless topology. Now next is whenever we are creating my security, we need to whenever we are creating my wireless network, we need to choose a particular security mode. So we need to go for WPA2, which is the most advanced security mode. Then we can always check whether we can go for a single cell wireless LAN configuration or multiple cell wireless LAN configuration. This depends on the topology. And finally, let's create a small you know, topology. So this already we have created. So let's you know, configure by connecting the access point. So here in this topology, let's take this access point as a connection of the network, and now I want so creating a bigger network with wireless access point controller is not scope of Cisco packet tracer. So let's create a server where this is my internet portion, this is my portion where we have you know, APs. So I am taking only one access point. We can take multiple access point. So whenever we are setting up in a home network for accessing internet, we can have this kind of devices. So we have taken a wireless router, wireless access point, PC, laptop, wireless printer, smartphone, tablet, PC for configuration in Cisco packet tracer. And we are configuring wireless router to access the internet. we are configuring wireless access point, and finally we'll test the connectivity. So this is the final part of my topology. So let's first check this wireless router is now is connected to internet. So I have already provided a live IP 1.1.1.2 static IP. So this part already I have done, and let's disable the DHCP server. So if we disable the DHCP server, then in my network this DHCP server can work accordingly. Now let me give a IP address 192.168.0.2, okay, in this particular interface, wireless interface, sorry, fast ethernet. We cannot provide any IP address here. What? Let's take it as a DHCP client, because this radio server can also act as a DHCP server. So let's go and configure DHCP server here. Let's switch it on. Gateway will be 1. DNS server will be 1.1.1. You can start with 10 and save it. If DHCP server is on, now you can see that already we have provided IP address. So this is not only, this is Redis server, Redis and DHCP server, for example. Now this is DHCP client. This will be DHCP client. So let me do one thing. Let's block this particular IP address. So what I'm doing, I am going and going to wireless MAC filter and prevent this to get connectivity. So reverse thing now. Now this PC can, now I'm connecting it to this PC. I'm checking laptop's IP address, a MAC address. This is 5D. So 5D I'm not blocking. 5D I'm not blocking. So in wireless security, wireless MAC filter. Okay. So now we can also remove it, or now again going back and permitting it. So you can see that this PC can be connected. Now I want every device now go and check IP address. It is not getting IP address. Now it got the IP address from the DHCP server. Now what I'm doing, I'm now checking whether it is having 1.1.1.1 connectivity or not. That means www.cisco.com. Now once we need to configure all those things, we can also check in my advanced setting whether advanced routing feature is there or not. So now in wireless security we have already seen that this particular server is connected. Now let me connect all the PCs with access point. So once we connect all the access point, what we need to do, we need to check, we need to provide that SSID. So Cisco is the SSID. So in laptop I am providing Cisco as SSID and changing it as Cisco 123. Once we do it, you can see that laptop will now come and connect to that router. So my topology is now complete. So this what we have done, to create a small topology. Now let's come back and check the quick configuration. So this is working as a DNS server. In DNS server what we have done, we have but in real life the DNS server is somewhat different. this is normally a DNS server which is in my scope of my router, scope of my Cisco packet tracer. Now this wireless router is connected to DNS server. Finally, I have taken a RADIUS server to create that connectivity. This PC connected with WRS, this wireless router. Now finally, this is connected to access point, and this DHCP server is providing IP address. Now go back and check whether it is getting IP address or not. So now you can see that this particular clients are getting IP address. In access point, what we have done, we have created SSID and password. Now we do not have any other configuration here in packet tracer, but we can still use some advanced techniques using access point controller. So access point controller is basically giving you a better configuration. So here in this case, you can see that access point is connected using WPA2, which is WPA2 personal, and this is WPA2 enterprise, where in this case the MAC address is authenticated. So this is a small topology we have created to understand how this works. So now coming to my configuration, if I am testing the connectivity, what I can do, I can ping. So for example, server, I can ping 1.1.1.1. If it is pinging, then I can say that this is working properly. So it should start pinging. Let's go and check whether it is getting properly IP address or not. Again, checking in the PC. Now going to the command prompt and pinging 1.1.1.1, and now it started pinging. In DHCP client also, we need to check the configuration. Sorry, wireless LAN, and now it should ping. And also web browser, we can check 1.1.1.1 or www.cisco.com. If it is working properly, then we can say that the connectivity from PC to internet is there, it is successful. So this shows that my topology is complete. So finally, we have tested the connectivity. So far what we have discussed is how to configure any wireless access point or wireless router, how to configure wireless clients. So we also give one more thing. First, not only wireless access point, we also learned how to configure wireless router. So this is also outcome of our study. So this is learning outcome. If you are talking about how to configure a wireless access point, then how to configure wireless router, then how to configure wireless clients, and finally we have shown, now since we know that how to configure all those things, we have shown you how to set up a small home network to access internet. So thank you, thanks for the patience hearing.